All right, welcome to those of you in the room and those of you at a distance. I'm delighted to introduce Carla Hickman here today, and I'm going to quickly provide a basic introduction that some of you may have already seen, but then I'm also going to just share some thoughts based upon our discussion over breakfast, which was incredibly insightful for me. Carla works with higher education leaders across the two-year and four-year sectors, overseeing research for the Community College Executive Forum and for leaders of continuing, professional, online, and adult education through the COE Forum. In addition to her time at EAB, she served as a business analyst with the Postsecondary Success Program at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. She started her career in education as an elementary teacher in New York City and Washington, D.C. She holds an MBA from Duke, where she studied marketing strategy and social entrepreneurship, as well as an MS for teachers from Pace University and a BA in political science at Colgate University. So really a rich set of experiences. And the two thoughts that I'll share in regard to my conversation with Carla earlier today is, number one, that she has the ability to observe a lot of very interesting things about higher education. She goes from campus to campus and immediately goes in the middle of really interesting discussions happening on each of these campuses. And I think from that perspective, she can really see patterns that exist, both in terms of similarities across each of these contexts, but also differences, as she notices how the conversations differ a bit, and understanding how these differences may relate to culture, mission, and other things about each of the contexts she visits. And for that reason, over breakfast, she shared a number of insights about what's taking place in higher education, about what we might do next. And they were so good that I want to immediately stop talking and give her the microphone so she can share them with you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that. Good morning, everybody. It is such a treat to be with all of you today, those that are gathered in the room, those that are joining us remotely. This is truly the joy of my job. I have the pleasure of serving as a managing director of strategic research at EAB. What that really means is that I have the opportunity to work with over 1,100 colleges and universities, truly tens of thousands of higher education leaders across North America. And our responsibility at EAB is to find and forge replicable solutions to the common challenges that are facing this sector. I've worked with EAB since its start. We first started working with higher education institutions back in 2007. You heard a little bit about my background, so I certainly brought my own biases to the table. I had worked in K-12, I had worked at a foundation, but I came into this work truly expecting how could we possibly from the outside have anything to offer to the smartest thinkers, the most creative individuals, the faculty of some of the best and brightest universities and colleges across the country. And what I realized very quickly was there was a hunger to understand the ecosystem at large, that the rules of the game were starting to change, and that the pace of change was such that it was difficult in the busyness of our day-to-day to stay on top of where things were headed. I have a relatively ambitious aim for our 90 minutes together today, and that is to share with you what we have seen in our research and our conversations with thought leaders, with students, with labor economists, with those who interact with higher education leaders, and preparing you for what we're going to call the new learning economy. I'm going to pull a rule here that I would never have done when I was teaching. I'm not going to define the new learning economy until more than halfway through the presentation today. So if that's a term you've not heard before, I'll leave you with bated breath. We will get there. I want to start, though, with how did we arrive at this topic in the beginning? Four sections to the presentation that you can see, a bit of a roadmap for our discussion today. I'm not known for talking slowly, so I'm going to try to pack in as much information and detail as I possibly can into a short period of time. That said, a discussion is always best when it's two ways, so we will pull up at two points in the presentation today. I'm very eager to hear your thoughts and questions. For those of you in the room, we'll have help moderating. For those of you who are participating online today, we'll also have an opportunity for you to participate as well. I work most closely, as you heard, with leaders of professional, continuing, online, and adult education. We call that forum COE because there truly is no one word or phrase that can capture the diverse range of activities that are undertaken by those units. And every year, we turn to our members and we ask them to set a research agenda. Where should we spend time and energy? What are the topics that are taking up more time on your personal calendar this year than in years past? Often they ask us to look towards the future. Where is higher education going? A member often tells me it's the Wayne Gretzky approach to strategy, right? You skate to where the puck is headed, not to where the puck is at. You can see here the titles of some of the studies on the left side of the slide that we've conducted to date. We've looked at things like engaging faculty in online education. We've looked at new pedagogical learning models. We've looked at competency-based education and how to organize activities on campus. Back in 2015, really late 2014, we got on the phone and we started to ask, where should we focus in the year ahead? And those questions were a little bit different than they'd been in years past. That's what you see here on the right side of the slide. The first thing that we noticed is that many individuals said, we need you to take a broader look. Higher education as an industry seems to be shifting. And the public discourse, the way that those outside of higher education talk about us, is changing as well. Help us to understand those trends. The second thing we heard is a theme around interconnectedness. It's the notion that we should no longer be talking about a certain student population or a particular credential or a particular delivery modality in isolation. That these are themes that are interconnected, that a 21st century university must be able to serve a diverse range of students through every modality, and it has to touch every corner of campus. I don't need to tell all of you how ambitious that is. That's where we're headed now. I want to start with the public discourse. This is the portion of the presentation where people get a little down in the mouth. I usually see facial expressions change. I'm going to move through this a little bit quickly, but we wanted to start with how is the rest of the world looking in at higher education? What are they seeing? And we boiled all of those articles we read, all of those research interviews we conducted, into these three basic questions. First, what subjects should we teach? If you think back to 2015, most folks remember Marco Rubio at a GOP debate saying that we needed more welders and less philosophers. It certainly set off a lot of fact-checking. We started to see how many welders are there in the United States? How many philosophy majors graduate? What sectors of the economy need more welders? What's their starting salary? The cynical among us said that a philosophy major would have said it was fewer philosophers, not less philosophers. The point being, though, it was this false dichotomy that it must be one or the other, that it must be the vocational or the liberal arts. Second question, how should we teach? Here we saw individuals who firmly believe in the power of active learning, of technology-enabled instruction, of flipped classrooms. It's the guide on the side versus the sage on the stage. Here's my bias. I am a firm believer in active learning. Even in my elementary school classrooms, everything we did was the flipped classroom model. Everything we did was about application in the moment, even with fifth graders. But, don't know if you saw this New York Times article, it was a very cogent defense of the lecture. So there's actually power, particularly for an undergraduate student, in watching a professor model an argument over time. How do they build that argument? How do they sustain it? Again, it's a false dichotomy that we have to have one or the other. And the third question, maybe the thorniest. Is higher education preparing students for work and life? Now, why this came up, I'd often be talking to a provost or a dean, and they would say, I just came back from a board retreat, and my board member or my donor had been reading articles in places like the Wall Street Journal and Forbes and the Harvard Business Review, again talking about how higher education needed to be disrupted completely. They were worried. What do I say in response? Now, I think that disrupted completely, the problem there is the adverb, it's the completely. And so we'll look in a moment, how do we change without completely getting rid of everything that is the tradition of the academy? The reason that many people stop in higher education at this point and shrug a little bit is that these don't feel like new questions. Those of you who have worked in higher education said, Carla, everything that's new was at one point a conversation in the past. We did a little digging because we're researchers. Back in 1976, Newsweek had the feature story that you see in the very small photo. If anyone in the room or online is interested, I can actually send you a PDF. We went to eBay and bought as many of these as we could find so I can take them on the road sometimes. In 1976, they looked at, is college a lousy investment? If you think about the economy back in 1976, same questions as we were hearing post-Great Recession. Here we've got students in caps and gowns that are on a construction site. Again, false dichotomy, vocational and liberal arts. There's a very strikingly similar article in Newsweek in 2012. There it's the Starbucks barista, not the construction worker. We took quotes from the two stories. We jumbled them up, put them side by side, and we asked people, can you tell me which one's from 76, which one's from 2012? You can't. I can't. I forget halfway through the presentation half the time. The fact is, we have had this conversation before. And it probably would be easy to just dismiss this as of the moment and not worth talking about. So why is it so different now? It's different because of what you've already looked at on the slide. Two factors that I think make this more urgent. One, the $1 trillion debt problem. We crossed $1.1 trillion of student debt in this country at a moment post-Great Recession when unemployment and underemployment rates were at their highest level. Now, those of you in the room have probably looked at that student debt data, and we'll look at it a little more closely in a moment, but the fact is that's the story. That's the headline, and it is a reality for many students and families in this country. The second problem, it's not just debt, it was questioning outcomes, falling in the OECD rankings, worried about US competitiveness, many stories about students who had been enrolled for years and never make it to the point of graduation. When you combine debt with a concern about outcomes, you do see regulation. You see more concern and more calls for accountability. That's the reality of 2015. What we dubbed 2015 was it was the year of higher education ROI and accountability. So what did that look like in practice? We've been trying to use some new research methodologies at EAB. One that we really love doing is a Google Trends analysis. So we did a really basic Google Trends search for, is college worth it? How many times do people search for that phrase? You see basically no one. 2007, you see a spike and it continued to grow. Now, I won't tell you that this is the kind of research I would write an article on site. I don't think that this is as rigorous as it should be, but it is a bit of a proxy for public opinion. The other thing that we noticed, I live in Washington, D.C. I've been there for about a decade. I was sharing with some folks last evening. I have never seen the federal government move this quickly on higher education policy. Probably would have to go back to the 60s and 70s to have this much action on the Hill in this short a time span. We've got a couple of those major policy moments in the timeline at the bottom of this slide. It started the year with white papers from the Senate Help Committee looking at everything from the disbursement of federal financial aid to new standards for accreditation. We ended the year with the announcement of EQIP. EQIP was an initiative to partner alternative providers with universities and colleges to allow through experimental site status federal aid dollars to flow to those students. This is a lot of action quickly, and I haven't even mentioned gainful employment, which is also a banner 2015 policy. Now, we are located in Washington, D.C., really by happenstance. Our founder back in 1979 opened the company in the basement of his mother's house in Georgetown. So we're not on the Hill, we're not a policy shop, but we're paying a lot of attention to these kinds of issues, especially as we enter Congress again thinking about Higher Education Act reauthorization. One of the measures we paid the most attention to, also 2015, was the college scorecard. How many folks here in the room have looked at College Scorecard. I would guess if you asked students and families, you'd get probably two or three hands as well. I don't think most high school students who are thinking about where to go to school are running to the White House's College Scorecard to help them make that choice. But the College Scorecard does bring a level of transparency, particularly around things like loan default rates and reimbursement rates that we haven't seen in the past. I don't think it's going to have a huge impact on student selection and recruitment, but I do think that we need to watch whether or not it becomes involved in the kinds of things that you see here on the right side of the slide. Will those rankings just be the beginning of a conversation about more aggressive measures? Things like tying the student's or the institution's ability to get federal financial aid to things like loan repayment rates. Even risk sharing with proposals where the institution might have to be on the hook for money if students default. There are actually lobbying organizations, policy associations like APLU who think land grants might actually fare well if we looked at that data. So there's a little bit of tentative support in DC, even from our own associations, for those kinds of measures. The other thing we're wondering is how will this data be repurposed by other information sources? We already know that the data is being used in certain rankings. The Economist and the Wall Street Journal are using elements of scorecard data in their institutional rankings. I don't think students and families run to the scorecard. I do think they look at these. And many folks are saying, how long will it take US News to decide to use this data as well? The other area that I think is interesting is how might this be used by an intermediary? So what do I mean by an intermediary? In other industries, a Yelp or a Priceline has shown up that has taken the ability for the institution, the provider, to control information. They've taken that away. They've aggregated data, and they've become the go-to for you to find information to make a choice, whether that's where you want to go to dinner or what flight you want to take. What if that happened in higher education? What if you went to a third party to sort what school was best for you as opposed to talking to the university itself? Now, there are a couple of nascent efforts here. The only one that I'm really paying attention to is what if LinkedIn became involved in this? So lots of 18-year-olds don't have profiles on LinkedIn. Their parents certainly do. And they've already started adopting some cool new search features. If you're a student and your ambition is post-graduation, I want to work at Pixar. Today, you can go to LinkedIn and search, where should I go to school if I want to work at Pixar one day? And what do they provide you? They provide you a list of the top 10 institutions with the most alumni who are currently working at Pixar. Now, that data is self-reported, doesn't have everybody, but their number of profiles is growing, and I again think that's only the tip of the iceberg. It's something we have to pay attention to. And I think we've always been thinking about student search in the adult, the online, and the working professional market. What I think is interesting is these new search behaviors are beginning to impact undergraduates as well. We speak with a lot of admissions officers, financial aid officers, vice presidents of enrollment management. What they say is what has long been the norm in working professionals, which is the stealth applicant. You only know about the student the moment that they apply. We're starting to see those numbers in the undergraduate population as well. This is relatively anecdotal data at the bottom of the slide. We poll our 300 COE Forum members every year. We ask them about their master's degrees, and we say, how many students would you classify as stealth? 2012 was about 40%. A couple years later, the outliers were as high as 70. Imagine what that does to your instructional planning. How many lecturers do you need? How many sections do you need? Are you even going to hit your enrollment targets? If you're not getting data and information about your prospect pool until the point of application, it's a terrifying position to be in. Today at the undergraduate, now this is across Carnegie classifications, across geographies and enrollment size, the number hovers between 30 to 40% of students are stealth. But what vice presidents of enrollment management are reporting is that just between the years of 2007 and 2014, that percentage has grown 12%. Stealth is coming to undergrad ed. And given how vital hitting our incoming class targets are in the undergraduate population, many admissions directors, marketing directors, and recruiting specialists are beginning to think about how do we recruit differently. We think this is about to get worse. Here's why. The undergraduate population, how many folks have heard of early FAFSA? So here's where I have to sort of have two brains. I think there's a lot that's really beneficial about the ability of a student and a family to apply for federal financial aid early in the decision process. I think that's a good policy recommendation. But here's how it affects you. It means that numbers are on the table much earlier in the student decision process. They are receiving their letter of admission and their award letter earlier than they used to. If you speak with financial aid directors, they say negotiation is already much harder than it used to be. No one thinks the final offer is the final offer. Families who can afford to are placing deposits at multiple institutions to hold spots and are willing to forfeit those dollars to negotiate until the last minute. Policy changes like early FAFSA, which again I think can really benefit students and families, will require that we think differently about the conversations and relationships we're building with our prospective students in the undergraduate admissions process. The other thing that's happening because negotiations have become so fierce is that pricing strategies that we have never seen in higher education are starting to show up. We do a lot of thought experiments with my research team at EAB. I'll take folks into a conference room and I'll say, get outside of higher education, think to other sectors, list as many somewhat gimmicky pricing strategies as you can possibly think of. It didn't take them long at all. You're seeing things like, oh, you can eat at the Golden Corral. I then said to them, is there a higher education institution who's employing a similar tactic? Usually they groan and roll their eyes and say, I need to go back to Google. I have no idea. That's a hard question. They made a laundry list of examples without ever leaving the room. Things like tuition price resets, subscription-based pricing models, which we're seeing in competency-based education, or FlexPath from Capella, for instance, even things like in-state price matching, where private schools are offering the same rates as the public institution down the street. It is becoming more competitive. We think this will only continue. Now, you'll have more regulation, and hopefully it won't be as gimmicky as the Golden Corral, but we do think we'll see more of this over time. We're also seeing institutions like UMass Lowell, for instance. They did a major rebranding campaign back in 2008. They were struggling with enrollments. They actually turned to pay scale data for part of that recruitment campaign. If you're familiar with pay scale, job seekers go to pay scale to get some sense of the salary for positions they might be interested in. But they also rank institutions based on what they call ROI. So how much did the education cost, and what was that starting salary? UMass Lowell did really, really well on the ranking, so they're using it in their advertising. Again, you might say, Carla, that's an anecdote. I don't think that that will be widespread, but I hope you can see if we continue moving in this direction, the world around us is changing. We have to have a response to these trends. That's undergraduate. I want to talk a little bit about masters. Let's return to this sense of college debt and student debt that we talked about before. It doesn't take you very long if you're watching the nightly news or you're reading magazines like Newsweek to see a story like the one we've captured here about a master's student who was going along fine in her career, chose to go back to school, graduated with debt, wound up in foreclosure, and was now 42 and living with roommates, which was the actual headline for this particular story. They love those sensational human interest stories. But why are they talking about them? It's because we know 40% of the student debt in this country are graduate students, even though they're only 12% of the total student population. They're disproportionately represented in that student debt. There are 20 schools in this country that are responsible for 20% of all student debt. 8 of them are for-profits. This is another moment where I think rightfully so, federal and state governments are looking at an industry, private sector colleges and universities. They're concerned about outcomes and debt. They're concerned about practices. They're implementing regulation that is affecting nonprofit higher education as well. Some of the policy changes we're seeing at the master's level, these are nascent and they're really only in conversation at this point. But we're seeing things like third parties beginning to benefit from access to federal aid. I've already talked about alternative providers. I'll return to General Assembly in a few moments, but General Assembly is a community for entrepreneurs. They offer many courses and certificates that resemble those universities and colleges might offer in areas like data science and digital marketing. We're also seeing status like Gallup, which is doing a survey longitudinally of the impact of student debt on a student's life choices. What they find is that students who graduate with a large amount of undergraduate or even graduate debt, they tend not to buy a home until later in life. They tend not to get married or start a family until later in life. And the other thing they delay, going back to school. They've started to turn not to the master's degree, but to shorter format credentials, things that they can earn faster, that have a demonstrable impact on their day-to-day or job ambitions, and also that can be completed by a wide variety of institutional providers. As I mentioned, this is the part of the presentation when people's faces get a little glum. It's not a ton of good news yet. Where I want to head for the rest of our time together is how do we, if that's the public discourse, that's what we're hearing, and that's what we're reading, and that's what we're sensing in conversations with our students and families. I would characterize that as an either or. It's that false dichotomy. We can either be vocational or we can be the liberal arts. We can either have lectures or we can have active and distance learning. It's this notion that we have to choose. It's the baby out with the bathwater. What I want us to do and what I'm going to try to do during the rest of our time together is start moving us towards the both and. How do we as higher education leaders better articulate the value we already deliver? If we changed nothing about what we do, we're already offering tremendous value to our students, our society, but how do we better articulate that so that policymakers and families and the media understand it? But while we do that, how do we examine where we actually do need to change? The world is changing around us, and we can't afford to stand still. So we're ahead of the rest of the time. So let's think about reclaiming value. I have the great privilege of working with about 500 provosts, universities and colleges across the country. Every year we speak with them on the phone and we ask them, how are things going on that strategic plan? What's enrollment looking like for this coming year? Where are the places where you're spending time with your leadership team? And one of the things we heard this year was not as specific as it had been in the past. In the past, you might imagine a provost answered that question. We have a large committee task force on first-year retention, and I'm spending a lot of time there this year. Or we're kicking off a capital campaign, and that's going to be my number one priority. This year, Provost got a little bit more existential. They said, Carla, I'm worried about the fact that it no longer feels like higher education is perceived as a public good. And then they would pause, just like I did, and they would say, you know what else I'm worried about? I'm worried that it might not be seen as a private good either. We've somehow lost the ability to communicate what land grants in particular were always intended to be, is in service to not only our students, their knowledge, their education, their well-being over a lifetime, but also in service to society, to our communities, to our states, and to our country. How did we lose that narrative? And in their words, this was a provost from a Florida institution, how do we reclaim our value? I think there are three things that are getting lost in the public discourse that what I posit is the beginning of an answer to that question. They're enumerated here for you on the right side of the slide. The first thing I want to talk about that I think is getting lost in the discourse today is, again, this notion that we have to make a choice to measure our value based on something as blunt as ROI, the salary of a student at 22 years old the day they step off campus. How did we get to a point where we were reducing the value of the great land grants of this country to that? I'm going to posit we need to move to what we're going to call return on education, not ROI. The second area we want to explore here that we think is getting lost is the difference between education and training. This, again, is the tension between often the practical, vocational, the liberal, comprehensive. I know I should have chosen, but I can't. I work with two-year and four-year institutions. Every time at a community college, I hear this debate raging. And this is what they live on a day-to-day. So I want to explore a little bit of what is the skills gap that we're hearing so much about, and why are we so confused about it? Why are we getting it wrong? And finally, we'll take a few minutes and talk about the value of the bundle and why I don't think Clay Christensen-style disruption is on the horizon. I will admit this story makes me a little bit sad, but in certain states, there is a concern now that because we've only been looking at something as blunt as salary on the day that we graduate, certain well-meaning programs, programs that are critical to the community but are low wage, could be on the chopping block. The Kentucky Community and Technical College System, KCTCS, say that five times fast. KCTCS are members of our Community College Executive Forum. They actually went to the trouble to develop what they called a social utility index. They surveyed graduates of programs like firefighting and early childhood education. They asked them things like, does your job make a difference for the world? They also, in that survey, tried to get a sense for things like, how long do you see yourself in this role? How committed are you? They looked at things like workforce needs and job needs in the region across the Commonwealth, and they then shared that with state policymakers. There was a moment halfway through that research conversation where you have to be a little bit sad that they felt like they needed to do that, that they needed to demonstrate in a quantitative way the value of an early childhood education program. But they said that's where we're at right now. There's a sense that employers are only focused on things like tax rates when they choose where to locate their businesses. We could have chosen any number of surveys. The truth is employers are most interested in an educated workforce to fill the job needs that they have. So many organizations are starting to look at things like, how do we better align the graduates and the programs that we have with the needs of our region and our state? Again, it's getting beyond how much will I make to what is the broader purpose of educating certain individuals in varied fields. This is a moment where many faculty will say, that's still relatively tied to jobs, Carla. Isn't there value beyond that? Of course. But this data is a good starting place. I want to quickly move into what I think is the most fascinating, in an area we've done a great deal of work at EAB over the last few years. That's this notion of what do we actually mean when we talk about education versus training? What is the skills gap? What I have found fascinating is that when you talk to employers, when you ask them, what are you looking for in a new hire, they are more often than not talking about the top of this T. How many folks have heard of T-shaped professionals? It's really swept Michigan. I'm not sure what's happening in Michigan, but Michigan has really taken this on. Michigan State has it as part of their general education curriculum now. The notion of a T-shaped professional is there are two kinds of skills we need over a lifetime. The top of that T are universal competencies, what many folks have called soft skills. Communication, presentation, leadership, intercultural competence. Those are the universal skills. When you interview employers and say, what do you most need in your workforce, it's the top of the T. You need people who can manage and who can lead. And at the entry level, you need people who can show up on time, right? Universal competencies. Now, what's the stem of the T? This is usually what we hear when you read an article about a skills gap. These are your specialized skills. This is that body of knowledge, that product, that process, that skill that you've developed. And the real value for employers, particularly over a career, is how do people put the full T together? I thought it was said really well by an employer who said, you know, I'm not hiring for people who can develop software applications. What I need is people who know how to use software to solve problems. Right? That's putting that whole T together. It's taking specialized knowledge. It's marrying it with universal competencies. In this country today, we often only talk about the stem of the T when we talk about the skills gap. What's been frustrating for many engineering faculty in particular is they say it's also very unspecific. They'll say, we need more engineers, looking at Renata. How many kinds of engineering? what does that mean? Or I need more folks who can do technology. I don't know what doing technology means, but it's not specific enough. What are the concrete skills and aptitudes that we're actually looking for? That lack of specificity makes it difficult for students, but it certainly makes it difficult for universities and colleges to respond in kind as well. The other problem that we're coming against is that top of the T problem is actually worse today than it used to be. Millennials, which again, just to remind folks, the oldest millennials are about 36 years old, but millennials are often being asked to assume management and leadership positions much earlier in their career. Think about post-Great Recession. Many jobs went by the wayside. Some were automated. Lots of employers wanting to do more with less. This meant that they asked young employees to take on 4 or 5 direct reports with usually 1, maybe 18 months of experience. What we also know is the relationship between the employer and the employee has irrevocably changed. Post-World War II, you graduated and started at a company, the expectation was you worked there until the day you retired. So the company had an economic incentive to invest in your training and development. The lifetime commitment they were making and assumed you were making to them. This is where we saw things like rotational programs and lots of corporate and chief learning officers that were part of the human resources suite. That doesn't happen today. The expectation is that people will switch jobs, switch industries, switch companies up to 20 times across a career. So it's actually not in the economic incentive of the company to invest a lot in their training and development. They're typically outsourcing that to the employee themselves or to other organizations. What better organization than you? What we also noticed here, and this is where I get a little bit into trouble, that soft skills problem, some are arguing, is different for the upcoming generations. There's a couple of books here I'd recommend, and I'm happy to share the list later. One I really appreciate was from a dean at Stanford who wrote How to Raise an Adult. Talked about the fact that these incredibly brilliant students would show up 18 years old at Stanford and have no life skills. They didn't show up on time, they didn't know how to manage their schedule, they didn't know how to find an office on campus. We've also heard quite a bit, if you not think about millennials, if you think about some of the generations coming behind them, things like everybody gets a trophy and all learning styles are equal and helicopter parenting. Some folks are positing that that is making students less capable at that 18 to 19 year old mark. Again, I'm not a parent, so I'm gonna step away from this at that point because I'm sure there are parents in the room, but there is scholarship out there to say this might be more problematic. The other thing that I think is fascinating is you talk to folks in their mid-20s that are considering going back for a certificate or a master's credential, they are often only looking for a technical skill. They say, I went to a liberal arts school. I took gen ed. I learned all that universal competency stuff. There's really a misunderstanding about the fact that those universal competencies change and evolve over the course of a lifetime in a career. What it takes to manage and lead at the entry level is vastly different than what it is at the senior or mid-career level. And we all know that there are actually all new things that we need to learn every day, whether that's intercultural competence that may not have been part of a program even a decade ago, or it's simply communication skills that if you don't practice them, you lose them. There is a tension here, though. And that tension is if we try to be too responsive to the market, if we try to be too aware of how industries are changing, may we actually be doing more harm than good. This is the story of petroleum engineering. 2008, fracking completely revitalized the oil industry, particularly in certain states, and there weren't enough graduates to fill those positions. So what did the universities do? They started their multi-year program development and launch process to start a degree in petroleum engineering. They did a lot of advertising to students about how phenomenal the job market was. You could graduate with a bachelor's degree and get a six-figure salary. Now, we all know, and I think rightfully so, developing and approving a new degree takes time. So a lot of universities missed it entirely. Those that were actually able to move quickly, they actually have been harmed because the bottom fell out. Oil prices started to drop in 2015, and even one institution admitted they sent a letter to incoming students saying, it's incumbent upon us to let you know that the promising job prospects that you may have read about in our course materials, those are no longer the case. So you're still admitted, and we'd love to have you in the program, but you should know that six-figure job is likely not to be. The reason I think that universities are missing here is they're trying to respond to those sensitive, hot jobs through the degree program. Instead of thinking about things like stackable modules, courses, certificates, things that are intended to be less permanent, that are intended to be developed and approved more quickly, and also allow us to stay on top of industries that shift and change. Higher education should not be launching and sunsetting degrees on an annual basis that quickly. Certificates and other more flexible credentials give us the ability to, again, not have either or, but to have both and. Programs that had offered specializations, elective coursework, or certificates in petroleum engineering did not fail as much as those that tried to make the degree stand for something that it couldn't. What I'd say here is that, again, they can complement one another. What I hear in my conversations is that most people want to pit the micro-credential, however you define that. It could be as small as an individual competency. It could be as broad as a certificate that might actually mimic the credit hours of a master's degree. But they're trying to pit the micro-credential against the master's degree. And what I'd say is that they're both going to be able to coexist. They can complement one another, and they serve students in different ways. They, in fact, serve different student populations, or they can serve a student over the course of a career and a lifetime. What we're seeing here enumerated in the four points is simply what I just stated. These can work together. And where I think they can be most powerful is when you consider the fact that you'd want a student to return to you after their undergraduate degree, maybe for a short certificate they need in management and leadership. Then they want to come back for a weekend intensive because they've just been promoted, they have no sense of budgeting, and they have to manage numbers for the first time. They come back for an executive workshop. They're then at a point in their career where they're ready for the master's degree. They come back and pursue that. But then after they're an alum of that, you want to provide them continued coursework, MOOCs, lectures, activities that they can invest in that help them to improve. They see you not as the place they got their bachelor's degree, but as their lifelong learning partner. So what's the value of the bundle? I'm going to pick on Clay Christensen for a minute. A couple years ago, I was doing a study on online education. It seemed about three decades too late, but we were tackling it in 2010. And often people would say to me, the question I get most often from my board or from a donor is, why can't the university just be disrupted like the music industry? I guess if we think back to Newsweek, Newsweek has likely fared worse than higher education between 76 and 2012. The fact is, a lot of people want to make higher education look like the $1.29 song that you buy on iTunes instead of buying the full album. There's a couple of reasons I think that falls apart. One is, if you think about music, your loyalty is to who? The artist, the person who sings, not the record label. It's different in higher education. Very few people pick a school based on a professor. They pick based on the institution as a whole. Now, there are exceptions to that, but as a whole, we're picking the university, the bundle, not the individual. Here's the other thing about the music industry. How many people are Spotify, Pandora? We're rebundling in the music industry as well. The thing was, people didn't necessarily not want albums or playlists. They just wanted the ability to customize them. Think about what that could look like in higher education. I want to be part of Penn State, but I want to have a little bit more customization in the way that I engage with the institution. I want to take some of my classes online, some of my classes face-to-face. I want to take a short format certificate. I want to have a summer experience. I want to maybe double major. Maybe it's not about the major at all. It's just that I want to do a capstone project. Right? It's customizing and rebundling in a different way. That, I think, is where higher education might move. That, I think, is exciting. And that's what I think we're seeing in the music industry as well. The other thing that I think is a little bit different here is the federal dollars, if I can be crass for a moment, they go to the bundler, not to the individual, which is also a little bit different. And I don't see that changing in the near term. I actually thought the Christensen model was a little bit stranger even than the iTunes analogy. This is the notion that Christensen said we had to pick a business model, that higher education struggled because it was trying to be three different types of businesses all at the same time. He said it was trying to be like a consulting solution shop. This might be where you think about the research enterprise. It was also trying to be like a manufacturing organization, the value-added process. And then if that weren't enough, we are also trying to be a facilitated network, an insurance company where the power is in bringing people together. And he said higher education has to pick one. You got to be the solution shop. You could be the manufacturing that manufactures degrees. And I only will say that once, and those are his words, not mine. And the third one is this notion that you could only be bringing folks together. I think it's too simplistic. I think the beauty of the research university is the value of the network. Here's one example I want to show you where I think we can see the both and. And I also think pundits are getting this one wrong. Folks in the room heard of Minerva? I love Minerva. I went to Colgate University, and there was a wonderful profile about a student who was choosing between Colgate and Minerva, and I actually interviewed her because I wanted to get a better sense. If you read an article about Minerva, what you'll hear is that it was launched by the former CEO of Snapfish, has a ton of venture capital, about $95 million of investment, and it has this really cool proprietary LMS. They think of it like the Brady Bunch. So for those of you who are faculty members and teach, imagine in your online learning environment, you can not only see all of your students like those little Brady Bunch photos, but you can also moderate discussion in a really fascinating way. You can know, is that student going to contradict something that was just said? Are they going to change the subject? Or are they going to add on to another comment? As a former teacher myself, not a faculty member, but teacher, I thought, man, that is glamorous. That would be really powerful. Students are not going to Minerva because of the LMS. This is what people are missing. Here's why they love Minerva. It's the best of both worlds. It is a residential experience. They started in San Francisco. They live in urban style lofts together. Their classes are taught online, but they're literally sitting side by side. And the best part of the Minerva experience is the experiential component. While they're in San Francisco, they go to a Silicon Valley incubator. After they're done in San Francisco, they'll go to Hong Kong. They'll go to Buenos Aires. They'll go to Tokyo. It is a global education, a residential education with the best of technology. Now, can we all be that? No. But I do think that that's what's getting lost. It's not the LMS. It's the power of that bundle. Although, frankly, I would love to play around with the proprietary LMS, I won't lie. That gets us to our six strategies. I plan to pull up here for just a few questions. If there are any questions on where we've headed so far, I'd be happy to take those from the audience now. Sorry, I should mention, because we have so many colleagues online, we're going to use microphones in the room.
Going back to your point about the debt of the master's degrees driving micro-credentials, I'm just wondering from the employer perspective, would they rather have a full degree, or are they satisfied with micro-credentials?
I think what we have seen so far is that it's going to be industry specific. It's going to be very tied to licensure and regulatory requirements. If you think about fields where there is a professional standard for the competencies that someone needs to demonstrate, if you think about a field where it's less important where you went and it's more important that you can demonstrate that you can do the task, that's where micro-credentials and employers see eye to eye. think that's why coding boot camps and technology-type micro-credentials probably took off first. But I can see that happening in others. We did a little bit of a thought experiment where we made a checklist, and we just thought, like, does everyone agree on what someone needs for professional accreditation? Is there licensure? Is there continuing education units? What I'm talking about there, by the way, that's more training. That's less education. The other thing that I will say, though, is that employers in general have a hard time with anything that's not a degree. They don't really understand certificates. And so I don't think that means slow down on certificates and micro-credentials. I do think it's important that you equip students to explain the value of those learning experiences, not only in their resumes and cover letters, but in their interviews with employers as well. Anything else from the room? We've covered a lot of ground so far, I know. All right, so all of you have been waiting very patiently for me to define the new learning economy. The time is upon us. So as we end today, I want to talk about what are the strategies? So how do we actually concretely move forward? What are we already seeing across higher education that I thought worthy of bringing to your attention today? First of all, I cannot take credit for the term new learning economy. It was coined by the Danish economist B.A. Lundvall. I will try to do his scholarship my best by explaining that in the 20th century, economic value was ascribed to those who had that specialized skill or body of knowledge. That was what made you valuable. In the new learning economy, it is the ability to gather, analyze, adapt that information to multiple situations and multiple problems. This is the moment where librarians tend to cheer. This is information literacy. I was actually at a college where I had a meeting with the library staff, and I thought, oh man, I hope this is relevant to their day-to-day. I'd never gotten a standing ovation on this slide before. They said, this is information literacy. Today, information isn't scarce, it's ubiquitous. And so the ability to actually understand what data and information is valuable, to gather the right sources, to apply it to problems, that is what makes you valuable. I think that's the point where we should actually stand up and cheer, because it benefits higher education in the ways that you see on this slide that I've already skipped past. We'll go back. First, it reinforces the importance of lifelong learning. Second, it makes certain that we need to start thinking about this notion of learning to learn, learning for learning's sake. Learning how to collect, understand, and interpret information. If you go back to the basics of education, it's Bloom's taxonomy. It's not enough to just know. We have to be able to synthesize and apply. The other reason I think that this is incredibly valuable is that it takes advantage of where you have a unique and differentiated asset, and that is the power of the multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary knowledge that exists nowhere else but America's research university. Nowhere else can you find this many scholars, disciplines, ideas, entrepreneurial ventures happening under one roof. You can bring people together to solve complicated problems in a way that other industries simply can't. So I want to share with you six strategies here. I'd be very curious to hear your reactions, and we'll leave some time for questions. So I'm going to move through these quickly. We're still doing research on many of these, so one of the things I often ask is which one intrigues you most, because we'd be happy to follow up with additional results. The first thing here is, how do we, in a very practical and simple way, begin breaking the trade-off between the vocational and the liberal arts? The professional preparation and the comprehensive education. It's a story from the former president of Kenyon College. She said she stopped a student on the quad and said, what have you learned at Kenyon? And the student said, well, I took a class on Milton and I played inter-varsity soccer. And the president walked away and said, nowhere in there did I think that was going to convince me that they had taken something unique and important away from Kenyon. I'm glad they remembered the Milton class. I would have preferred if they could have talked about things like critical thinking. Memorial University of Newfoundland was faced with this issue. They had a number of their students who were really struggling to find employment, and that they were in the midst of a learning outcomes and assessment conversation on campus. What they realized is they rarely needed to change the syllabi. the courses themselves and the content of those courses didn't need to change. What they needed to do was better articulate to students and faculty alike what are the practical skills that the student is learning in this course. They had a group of deans and faculty and administrators who came together, defined the competencies you see here on the gray box. They then sat down, an instructional designer with a faculty member, took the existing syllabus and coded those competencies. You've got a presentation in week 3 of this course that's working on these presentation and communication skills. They were spelled out on all of the syllabi. They were discussed in the courses, and career services supported the students in their curriculum with understanding what those competencies mean and why they're valuable. Career services actually took a group of education majors to a career fair, and they ran a fairly unscientific experiment. But they said, go up first and just say, I'm an education major. Do you hire students like me? And a lot of these companies were places like marketing firms and financial services, and they said, oh, maybe we have one or two education majors. Then they said, don't lead with your major. Tell them what you've learned and what you can do. They went up and said, I can take a complex problem, break it down into its components, and teach it to anyone. I have the best communication and presentation skills you've seen. They said, you know what? We have something for you in training and development in our management program. It really is about code switching, and it's empowering the student to understand in practical terms what they're learning beyond the knowledge of their discipline and the theory, which is important, but not always as practical in the interview. This is a simple exercise for them. Again, I think the trigger here was faculty were part of the discussion of what the competencies should be, and they actually didn't change any of the courses. They simply began to talk about in a new way what they were already doing. This example is a little bit different. There's a new program at NYU called Professional Edge. It is open to juniors and seniors in the College of Arts and Sciences who have a certain high GPA. They are eligible to enroll in certificates that are offered by the NYU School of Professional Studies. These are the same certificate programs that serve working professional adults. Their fees are actually paid by the College of Arts and Sciences. So there is a payment internally on campus. These students are the best of the best. So not anyone can apply. They go through an application process. They have to meet with an advisor. It doesn't count towards their undergraduate GPA, but in order to be able to list that they've earned the certificate, they have to earn at least a B in all of the coursework. That Professional Edge program has been incredibly popular. It's allowed folks who are interested in fields like journalism to take a digital advertising or a new media certificate and couple that with their English or communications degree. It's another way that I think universities are thinking about the both and, not the either or. I also want to touch on experiential education, and here I want to switch and think about, what about our distance learners? What about our adult learners? What about those that are still working part or full time? One of the most interesting things about studying experiential education is trying to define it. It could be undergraduate research. Some people say it's anything that's not a lecture. But the most common answer I get is the internship. How do we scale is the question I hear from provosts. If you have a large enrollment base of either undergrad or grad students, how do we make an internship possible for as many students as possible? What I thought was interesting here is, I apologize for this acronym, it's the rise of the MOOE. Again, I take no credit for that. It's the Massive Open Online Internship. These are virtual internships. They've long been part of things like the capstones of professional science masters at UMUC. Those students are working with companies through an online platform, discussion boards. They own parts of projects, but they never have to physically relocate to where that company is located. The other thing that I think is really interesting is a startup. So I admit this is relatively nascent, but it's called Coursol. That was started by an alum from Brown University. The goal here was to take that same idea we've seen, where could we make a platform where any company could post a project that they needed completed, and we could crowdsource lots of users. You can sign up to Coursol, complete one project for a company for free. If you want to do more than that, there's a monthly subscription. For those of you who think about business models, you can imagine that they sort of ran out of steam fairly quickly with that business model. So now what they're thinking about is university partnerships. Not only does it make the company more likely to post a project if their alma mater participates, but it also means that the students who are working on the projects are likely under the direction of a faculty member. There's a little bit more confidence that you'll get good work at the end of that project. UVA and Coursera are one of the early partners in CourseSolve. Again, this is allowing students who may not be able to afford the luxury of taking a low-paying or no-pay internship or be able to physically move their family or their life to work at a company to benefit from experiential education in the same way. Return to my old friend General Assembly here. I actually secret shopped a General Assembly course. For those who are not aware, they were launched around 2009, 70,000 students, 29 offices, 4 countries. Their community of entrepreneurs, what I think is fascinating is all of their courses and certificates are taught face-to-face. And what they really tout is the power of their alumni network. No matter where you are in the world, they say, if there's a General Assembly office, you've got a place to be. You can come to our free events, you can meet our entrepreneurs, you can just have a table to code. What's really interesting about General Assembly is the fact that they are replicating some of the best bits of higher education. They're looking at the power of place and the power of the alumni services and the alumni network. The reason why I bring this to your attention is I think what they have figured out is that students need a different kind of relationship, a different kind of skill acquisition and educational opportunity after they've earned the bachelor's degree before they pursue the master's. And General Assembly today, high priced, 70,000 is impressive, but they didn't scale beyond that intentionally. They're fairly selective about the students that they serve. What they said the power is if universities began offering this kind of model, be out of business in a day. They're often called boot camps, to use the military term. I would point you towards Rutgers and Northeastern, who had incredibly successful launches of their boot camps. Not only did they serve new student populations, but I think what's wonderful is it was a service to their undergraduate alumni. Finally, I want to talk about new partnerships and how do we adopt some of the principles of a competency-based education model without necessarily offering programs fully in that format. Two that I think are fascinating, new partnerships between Udacity and Google, where they are developing an employer-based curriculum for their Android developers. Google is very involved with what that curriculum should look like, and students only take courses they need that benefit the projects they're looking to complete. They also, the best in those programs, have the opportunity to meet with the engineering interviewers in person at the conclusion. It's the idea, especially for the working professional, you don't have to take everything. Let's make it as practical as possible for that next step in your career. We're actually seeing this at traditional institutions as well. This is University of Michigan's MS of Health Professions. They took some of the principles, again, of competency-based, not soup to nuts the model, but principles of it, and they said, what if we worked really closely with our healthcare employers and we thought about what do people actually need to learn and demonstrate to be successful on the job? And let's find a way to personalize their pathway through the program. Now, to make this work, it's relatively small, and they needed a strong employer partner who could actually articulate the competencies that they needed in their future workforce. But I think it's a sign that we're moving in this direction. I'm actually going to skip over this one, and the last place that I want to lead us with is how do we find a way, again, to respond to market needs? I love the work of Peter Capelli at Wharton, who says they're hot jobs for a reason. It's because no one could have spotted them. So it's very difficult to apply that Wayne Gretzky strategy to the day-to-day development of new coursework and programs. But there are some trends we're seeing at universities that make you a little bit more agile, a little bit more responsive. I want to just share 3 quick ones with you today. The first that we're seeing is starting to create those pop-up module specializations, certificates, micro-credentials within an existing program. Look to Mount Holyoke here. They have some really interesting pop-up minors that are focused on complex multidisciplinary topics, things like the global water shortage, sustainability, that cross the curriculum. Students can enroll in that minor in addition to their major, but Mount Holyoke knows that those topics and themes are going to need to change over time. So they're relatively easy to sub in and sub out of the curriculum. The departments and the colleges make those decisions. The other thing that we've noticed here is building the ship while sailing. So folks are starting to launch certificates. They're taking that to market, gathering data and information that can actually benefit their proposal for a full master's degree. By the time they've made it through the master's degree approval process, they have a ready-made cohort of students who are interested in transitioning from the certificate to the master's. And even if those students don't come back for the credential, they have ambassadors who can speak about the benefits of the work. The final thing I'll say is if you're relying on a standing committee that meets on a rigid calendar in person to approve proposals, we're starting to see how that could absolutely make it difficult to move at market speed. So some of what we're seeing here are virtual meetings, committees that are meeting only when there's a need to meet, and going to electronic voting, which means that if a faculty member is not physically located or capable of meeting at a particular time, can still move a little bit faster than what standard may have been in the past. So a few smiling faces there, so I hope I left you with something there. I'm going to open it up to questions here, and the last one that I'll leave you with is just getting us back to our land-grant roots. What does outreach look like in the new learning economy? I think we often forget, again, in being a public good, it's not just about the well-being of our students. It's not just about the fact that we have incredible courses and programs, it's also about our research and our community outreach. One of the ones that I love is My Horse University from Michigan State. It is the place to go for anyone who has ever thought about, loved, cared about, researched a horse. If you are an enthusiast and you have a horse and you want to watch a video, you can go here. If you're a PI and you're looking for somebody who can go in on a grant with you, you can go here. If you simply want to read the scholarship of Michigan State on equine research, My Horse University is the place to be. For them, this is outreach from a land grant in the 21st century. Final example is MIT. They took a page from the tech sector again, and they said, you know, we've all heard of hackathons where we get folks together in a room. It's true that we have folks across disciplines and scholarly areas who could bring their intellectual horsepower to solve problems, but how often do we see one another? How often do I get across campus or across the quad? MIT Hacking Medicine is intentionally bringing faculty, graduate students, and staff together from across the institution for a 48-hour hackathon to solve a real problem. They do agile design, they do prototyping in the moment. One of the things I loved most is they actually developed a handheld resuscitator for infants that could be used by emergency responders. So they brought together the person who studied automotive engineering with the pediatrician. Those folks don't typically bump into each other unless it's at the cafeteria. They brought them together to solve a problem. Again, I think this is the power of the network in the new learning economy. I'm going to leave you there. I have run long on time, as I always do, but I would be welcoming any questions at the end today.
Does this work?
Okay.
We were up in the mezzanine, but I thought I'd come down for my question. So I have two questions, but I'll start with one to give everyone else another chance. Of course, I typed it on my phone just to be clear. So we have partners that we've worked with for years and years through at World Campus, and some of the where we're hitting now is we have a lot of the main programs that we offer in disciplines that everyone would consider under, you know, common, accounting, finance. These are all very, these aren't brain, you know, rocket science to figure out we need those. But now we're starting to get proposals for programs for full degrees, $30,000, $40,000 degrees that would be in very, very niche areas. And we go through the same curricular affairs processes that we would have for any degree. It's not different for us. So they're saying, well, we want a certificate in this, or we want a full degree in this. And we're looking at it thinking, is this really a whole sort of degree, or is it one course? Or is it a collection of non-credit courses? My question is, what is your overall thought on approaches for that when we start to get very niched degree requests when in fact we think there's a need for that type of education mm-hmm. or training, but not maybe as a whole degree.
I think what I've seen work at other institutions is a few things. I've not looked at your program development proposal criteria or what a faculty member or program director would submit, but it's very important to think about what is the ambition for scale and what kinds of data could we use, whether that's peer and competitive programs, whether that's labor market analytics, if it's student focus group data, what is it that can demonstrate the viability of that particular program? What cohort size can we anticipate, and then how can that scale over time? So I've seen a lot more rigor in the program development process around, one, how many years to break even? What will the tuition and revenue arrangements be on the back end? And then what is the actual ambition over time? Is this 100 students at scale? Is it 1,000 students at scale? Is it 10? That becomes that first screen. I'd imagine you do a lot of that. The second thing that they then do is never go back with the hard no, but then go back with the, here are the options that we could see. We agree there's viability here in this particular field. Penn State may be a leader in that niche area, but what about if we start with a certificate? So it's the build the ship while sailing. Let's start with a certificate. Let's demonstrate viability, work out the kinks in the curriculum, and continue the approval process towards the degree while we do that. So it's creating sort of a moment where you can pull back up and reconsider.
So that actually very naturally leads to my other question then, so I'm just going to go ahead and ask it, is our approach has been that we are trying to stay away from freestanding credentials at certificates mm-hmm. unless they are embedded or are on the way to a master's degree. So it's almost like a two-part approval mm-hmm. where we say, we'll do a certificate here as long as it leads to a master's degree, and we make it a full conversation, and mm-hmm. it's embedded. So if someone comes with a certificate alone, we sort of say, unless it's already, we'll head towards a master's degree, we'd need to talk about it further.
I think that stackable credential is exactly right, so I'm heartened to hear that, because I think this notion of stackability is how we serve students. The only model I would say is a little bit of a twist on that, is rather than it always having to lead to a master's degree, is it a group of related certificates that the student might take over time? I've seen this work particularly well in things like leadership and management, where there's an early career leadership certificate that is coupled with an advanced leadership practicum or certificate. Business schools in executive education have kind of done this over time. So you might think about a cluster approach to certificates that don't always have to terminate in a degree.
Loved your presentation and your remarks. A lot of good food for thought in there. One of the things that you didn't mention explicitly, but it was embedded in many things, was the use of data. And I think what we're seeing is a lot of interest and opportunity in analytics, learning analytics or data analytics when it comes to the mm-hmm. kind of environments we're working in. Mm-hmm. And so far, my sense has been there's been a lot of development, but it's still not as mature as some of the other things that we would say are useful in helping us make decisions. I wonder if you could comment on what you're seeing in the field of data analytics when it comes to the educational environment. You know, there's other parts of analytics that are used at a university, but I'm really talking about as it relates to the learning and the educational experience.
Yeah. What I think is interesting about learning analytics that I've been watching is I think people, when they first thought about data and analytics for learning, they just got daunted. They wanted to have hundreds of observations and variables and a very complex regression model to understand what was meaningful and what wasn't. I actually look to leaders like Rio Salato, which is a very impressive community college with large base of online students. They said, keep it simple. They take their learning management system and they actually only look at four things. There was a really interesting article in Inside Higher Ed this week where Blackboard was doing some of this. So I don't know if anyone noticed it. They look at logins, So does the student actually log in? Then they look at clicks within the learning environment. So what I thought was interesting about the Blackboard study, I'm going to go find it as a researcher, but I'd encourage you to as well. Blackboard found that students who actually checked their grades frequently in the LMS had higher grades at the end. So maybe the more conscientious students were constantly tracking every quiz. They looked at things like what kinds of content are they engaging with. So they were able to notice if a student was constantly going back and rewatching a taped lecture, constantly going in and re-examining a quiz or trying to retake it, and those students were flagged for intervention by the instructor or the advisor. So really basic interactions that the student was having in the LMS had enormous predictive power. That's the simple. I think what we're also watching is adaptive learning. I think the ecosystem and the technology for adaptive learning is relatively immature. I went to GSV, which is the large global social venture ASU sponsored. I did notice there was a shift. There were more folks talking about predictive and adaptive learning than in the past, but a lot of those folks are still in search of a business model and a technology that works. ASU has decided to make a lot of bets. They're kind of working with everybody, so I actually think, great, let them do that, and we'll see where it sorts out. But I think that's what's promising in the future, to understand an individual student's pathway through a curriculum. I just don't think it's there yet.
Hi, Carla.
Hi.
So I have three questions. First two are quick, and I think probably have quick answers as well.
Great.
We currently on new certificates. Mm-hmm. Would you recommend that we might want to
resolve? You're going to start with that one for me?
Yeah. That's a yes or no. Is that something we should resolve relatively quickly?
I would resolve it relatively quickly, yes indeed.
The second one.
I didn't vote one way or the other, by the way.
Excellent. So there still is a ban on undergraduate, or there isn't? Okay, great. Second question.
Yes.
Have you ever encountered a university that thought competency-based education was contrary to graduate school policy or graduate school philosophy or anything like that?
And more often than not, I find folks who don't have a common definition for what competency-based education is or means. So at those institutions, they may think it is contrary because they're struggling with what do we actually mean by defining competencies and measuring progress against them.
Great. Those are the two questions.
All right, give me the more complicated one.
I liked what you said about it's not either or, it's both and credentials, micro-credentials, mm-hmm. might be issued in conjunction with degrees, mm-hmm. or at the same time people are moving through. And in order to help undergraduates articulate their mm-hmm. skills, I think those could be very meaningful, mm-hmm. Especially if they're done correctly. I saw Deakin University doing things like identifying those characteristics, like in your gray box, communication skills mm-hmm. and critical thinking, those things, and giving not just one micro-credential in that, mm-hmm. but giving those in the different places they occur throughout the mm-hmm. curriculum. You talked about one university mm-hmm. identifying, going through the syllabus,
right.
and identifying the places. So it seems to me like a student could leave with a critical thinking badge in economics, a critical thinking badge in subject areas, and they could mm-hmm. end up with considerable help. I just came from Career Services on my way over here. So we also are thinking that these badges might be, or micro-credentials might be a great way to involve alumni.
Mm-hmm.
Because alumni, what employers are looking for is that verification that somebody, and they do an interview, and it's hard to pick up those things. But if we were to engage our alumni in the ongoing process of students earning these credentials as they move through a program, seems like that would be a pretty important way to both build alumni support and help students. Have you heard of others that are engaging alumni in the issuing of credentials?
I have on two ways, and a little bit of an extra add-on that made me think of it when you brought up badges. One is, I would say, a badge has to represent learning, and so this is often tied to an e-portfolio or a portfolio exercise. So rather than having a communication or critical thinking badge in different disciplines or courses, it's more likely that activities or papers that you've written or tests that you've taken in those different courses build a portfolio that allow you to have that particular badge. The other thing that I've noticed is it doesn't have to just be about your academic or curricular experiences. Places like the University of Akron have a fairly active badging program that's about extra and co-curricular learning as well. It's connected with their student affairs and career services staff so that students understand the value of those activities in addition to or as a complement to. When it comes to alumni, it's one, a way for the alumni, again, in a quick way to re-engage. So they might participate in a MOOC that Penn State offers and then can get a certification from Penn State that might be a badge or a digital certificate. The other thing, though, is having alumni help the student actually articulate the value of what that badge is. Folks don't know badges in the employer world. I do think that will change as LinkedIn tries to do more here. But right now, people think Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts when they hear badges. It's just the truth. I think that that will change, but the way that that changes is helping students be able to say, not I got a badge in critical thinking, but here's how I can demonstrate critical thinking and the kinds of learning activities I pursued during my undergraduate education.
We have a question online from Adelina Hristova. She asks, I love your point about the false vocational and liberal arts dichotomy. Mm-hmm. How would you address the critique that the higher education favors the formal over informal learning, another false dichotomy?
I think that's really interesting. I think that comes down to conversations I have about credit for prior learning and prior learning assessment. Many organizations are still, again, confusing those two terms, confusing PLA with competency-based. It's a little bit of a Tower of Babel when it comes to these things right now. I think for informal learning, particularly with an institution who has a commitment to what I'll call the post-traditional student, students working part-time, students who are adult learners and distance learners, credit for prior learning and informal learning exercises has to be part of the future. It has to be. There are organizations in this country that were founded on that principle, places like Excelsior. There are organizations that I think have phenomenal systems. Thomas Edison State University in New Jersey has one of the best credit for prior learning programs. Why is it great? One, because it's led by their faculty. Two, it actually brings a great deal of rigor to what those students can demonstrate to a future or current employer. And third, it helps us to reach populations of students, particularly veterans and military service members who have not had access except at select institutions in the past. So I appreciate that question. It's one I'll take back to the team because I think it's a great one to add to the list.
So I had one question. I enjoyed your discussion of disruption. And I kind of agree with you about the more grandiose claims that are made about disruption, and the evidence to date has called them into question, and you also walked through them logically. I also think of disruption on more minor levels, and usually I think of disruption to those activities that are essentially cross-subsidizing other parts of the university, right? And so you could think about disruption to the large undergraduate courses that generate net revenue on average to pay for the other things that lose net revenue. You also think to disruption in terms of certain parts of professional graduate education that are often a cross-subsidizer as well. And so anyway, what's interesting, your thoughts about those parts of disruption, but given the financial situation facing many colleges, universities, even without disruption, they may have trouble paying the bills in 10 to 20 to 30 years. With disruption of those cross-subsidizers, you could think of it. But what was also interesting to me was that you were talking about coding camps, boot camps at Rutgers, because it could be the traditional higher ed institutions that are one doing the disruptions as opposed to new entrants. And so your thoughts on if there are these disruptions to specific activities, who will be doing the disrupting and to what extent are traditional college universities well-placed to be those entities?
There's a lot to work with in that, so thank you. I did not mention one of the elements that was on a slide, which was a quote by Jeff Salingo. Those of you might know, Jeff was at the Chronicle. He's written a number of books on higher education and the future.
And he's a Penn State graduate, by the way.
He is indeed. You might have heard of him. Jeff had said, you know, people thought disruption would come at the undergraduate level. He posits that's not at all the case. If we're disrupted anywhere, it will be in the professional space. It will be in the graduate education space because there's more freedom and flexibility and because working professionals behave differently
differently. Their consideration set and choice architecture is different than that of an undergraduate student. So I do think that some of the areas of the campus who have long been subsidizing other activities are those that we need to watch the closest. This is why I think disruption will come not only from startups and accelerators and private sector firms. I think it will come from the university and colleges themselves. I don't think that it will always look like large research universities or those with large undergraduate populations. I think where I'm seeing it, regional publics that are very enrollment distressed, small privates, and liberal arts universities who have had a commitment to pre-professional education but now find that they have got to make some tough choices in order to move forward. The university I always point to who made some real, two actually, that made those choices early on and I think have been disrupting silently without a lot of folks noticing are Stetson University in Florida. Stetson has a traditional liberal arts campus, but it's largely supported by a very robust online arm. And the universities in Florida, both public and private, are now looking at Stetson as a real competitor for share. The other that I always think of is Lamar University, which is out in East Texas. And Lamar was one of the first that partnered with an online program management company to offer online education at scale. So Lamar, at the time, it was Higher Education Holdings. It was an alum named Randy Best. That's Academic Partnerships, which you may have heard of today. But Lamar really transformed their College of Education in Arts and Sciences. They have enormously scaled. They're pulling back a little bit, but it changed the trajectory of that institution. So I think it's those kinds of stories that we don't often hear because they're outside of our peer group. Those are the ones we look for in EAB and try to bring forward to our members, but that's where I think the biggest disruption will come from.
So we're at 11:29, so unless anyone has a 20-second question that could be answered in 40 seconds or less, I think we'll just thank Carla for the insight she shared with us today.
Thank you.
And greatly appreciative.
Thank you, everyone.